Good afternoon. Be it that this is an informational hearing, and I like to be respectful of people's time, and I see that we have President Peavy here, and I do have a Republican member here. We're going to start this UNC hearing, and today's purpose of this hearing is to get our annual update from the Public Utilities Commission that is required to the legislative body. This will be an overview of the 2010 activity that took place with the PUC, and there's no secret there has been a lot of, or there was a lot of activity last year from telephone deregulation of that industry, and as well as the San Bruno pipeline. I want to again extend my condolences and to the families and communities that were impacted by that tragedy. As we move forward, I'm excited about the new body of commissioners that are now part of the PUC, and I expect a more regulatory action that will take place and be in the best interest of all California ratepayers. Also, I'm pleased to inform you the direction that you believe the commission should go with regard to ensuring reliable electric service and regulating a diverse array of public utilities. So our vice chair is next door, and Mr. Fletcher is on another hearing. So once he arrives, I will allow him to make statements as well. But in the interest of time, I'm going to invite President Peavy to come forth and begin your comments.
Good afternoon, Chairman Bradford. It's a pleasure to be here. With me, sitting on my immediate right, is Paul Clannon, who is the Executive Director of the Public Utilities Commission. I also have brought with me from San Francisco today several people that head up different aspects of the commission, our Consumer Protection Safety Division, our Energy Division, our Telecommunications Division, and so forth. So those questions that you have that I may not be able to answer, I'm sure that we'll have answers for you. Okay. I believe last Thursday or Friday you were all given a copy, a rather detailed copy of the update of the material for the year 2010. I don't propose going through it all unless you would like to stay here till 6 or 7 p.m. But I do want to hit a few highlights by subject matter areas. First, as you just indicated, the commission itself has undergone change. Two commissioners' terms ended at the end of last year, and that was Commissioner Bond and Commissioner Gruning. And the governor, Governor Brown, has appointed Catherine Sandoval and Mike Florio as commissioners, and we anxiously await an appointment of one other commissioner that will then give us a full body. As you know, we are a pretty active organization. We're in energy, communications, consumer protection and safety, consumer complaint resolution, passenger transportation, rail safety, and water are just some of the subjects that the PUC is in. What gets tremendous amount of attention is, of course, energy, not just the what happened in San Bruno, the very regrettable accident there that killed eight people, including an employee of the Public Utilities Commission and her daughter, but many other things as recently as this past weekend's earthquake and tsunami in Japan and implications some feel may have for some California operations in the energy field. If you turn to page 6 just quickly, you'll see that we have tried to, it's something I've been very interested in, keeping electric rates at some reasonable proximity to cost of living, the consumer price index, and they have been. Since 2003, rates have gone up slightly less than the consumer price index. They've all gone up, but it's been at less of a pace than a lot of other sectors of our economy, like medical, where it's 9 or 10% a year, as we all know, and so forth. We have a lot of different programs in low-income areas I'm happy to talk about, in energy efficiency, and in renewables. These are the things that get a tremendous amount of attention. I would just like to say that that in the energy efficiency area, we're spending well over $1 billion, through the utilities, are spending well over $1 billion a year in energy efficiency programs now, with an additional $750 million, approximately $250 million a year for low-income home retrofits in the energy space. We think that this has been a tremendous, tremendous program that has saved ratepayers billions of dollars and created at least 15,000 new jobs, if not more, in this state. And it's transforming the residential and commercial markets. We are very, very much committed to advancing the smart grid in California, and this is a legislative leadership has been provided on the Senate side by Senator Padilla and by others here in this committee. To date, investment is going to approximate about $5.6 billion in smart grid, which is the personification of this comes as so-called smart meters. I just want everyone to understand that while we hear a little bit of negativism about smart meters in portions of Northern California, the program overall is going extremely well, and over 11 million meters have now, new meters have been installed, over 2 million by Edison, over 2 million by San Diego, hundreds of thousands right here in this city by SMUD, which we don't regulate, Glendale, everything else. PG&E's installed over 7.7 million meters. They have been the lead utility and gone first in this. In the renewable energy space, the record for last year was, Mr. Chair, was really incredible. Edison, we have a statutory requirement to hit 20% by the end of 2010. We didn't make it, but Edison came to 19.4%, which is really awfully, awfully good. And under the legislation in SB 722, and that's moving now, they have a little freedom of time on that till 2013. But they're going to hit it this year. PG&E is at 17.7%, so up from 14.4 to 17.7 in 1 year in percentage points. That's a very big step. San Diego Gas and Electric is at 11.9%, up from 10.5%. So there has been a significant movement in this area, which gives me confidence that we will get to 33% by 2020 in this state, if not even better than that. And the program that this legislature asked us by statute to do, the California Solar Initiative, has going great guns. We have over 56,000 different buildings that now have solar on them, or soon will. The megawatts are approaching 1,000 megawatts. And the incentives, and we have this graduated incentives that go down. The incentives are down at the eighth tier now. So we started out giving an incentive of $2.50 a watt to people that would put solar on their house. It's now down to 35 cents a watt in the PG&E service territory, and demand has not declined. Now, there's a big federal tax credit that really helps in that, one has to say, and, you know, very strong support from the national administration, President Obama and others. But that program is going a great gun. So we're doing great on renewables. We're doing great on a portion of renewables that are the solar initiative, which is not counted as part. When I say Edison is at 19% renewables, I'm not counting the solar initiative piece within their service territory. If you did, they'd be over 20%, and PG&E would be at 20%. Just so that it's a different counting method, but it's all there. So all of that is going ahead, I think, very, very well. And I've mentioned energy efficiency. We are very involved in the new governor is very interested in distributed generation at the local level, and it's incumbent upon the PUC working with the utilities to try to speed up the process of integration of that new generation into the system, and we're well on our way to doing that, and we have been very active in approving transmission. Every major transmission project that has come to the Public Utilities Commission has been approved by the Public Utilities Commission over the past 3 years, whether it's from so-called Rainbow to the River Line in Southern California, or the Sunrise Line in San Diego, or the Tehachapi Line, or the Ivanpah Line. These are all meeting with success by this commission. I do want to mention the whole situation about San Bruno, and because it is a matter that in Northern California in particular, but all across the state and across the country, has got a tremendous amount of attention, and rightly so. This is a small likelihood, big impact event. This state, our Public Utilities Commission, and other states, we've all followed pretty much the same practices on pipeline safety. I think it's fair to say that to some degree, we've been found wanting in that regard in terms of what happened there. It's not that anybody could have guessed that there was at a regulatory body that there was a pipeline that had a well that goes back to 1956 and all, but nonetheless, we've had a very severe consequence of that. And the whole nation is looking at California and what we're going to do as an outcome of that. To my right, as I said, is our executive director, who has almost taken on a full-time job on just pipeline safety on this issue. He was in Washington 2 weeks ago, spending the day with three or four days with the National Transportation Safety Board, which is the federal agency that actually took. If you look at page 18, you'll see a picture of the pipe that exploded. That has gone through that in painstaking detail at their lab and training center and evaluation of that. Shortly after that accident, I was determined that this tragedy requires us to take a new look, not only at how we regulate externally gas pipeline safety, but also our own procedures as an entity. And I appointed, with the concurrence of my colleagues, a 5-member independent panel to look into this. And on page 25, you'll see the members of the panel, headed by the former chancellor of UC Davis, Larry Vanderhoff, Pat Lavin, IBEW member, Carl Pister, the chair of the California Council on Science and Technology, Paula Reynolds, a former CEO of a major gas company, and Jan Shorey, the former head of the SMUDs, Sacramento Municipal Utility District. They have been meeting with PG&E. They've been meeting with outside experts. They've been meeting with consultants. They've been meeting with SoCal Gas Company, which is also a big gas provider in the state of California. And they're going to have a report out in May or early June at the very latest, I think in May, that it's going to be a very extensive report. In addition, we have set up a whole process with an order instituting investigations and rulemakings, both on past behaviors, including the inadequacy of records that PG&E has kept, as well as going forward, what new rules and how should we do regulation in this industry. And that panel will recommend changes in the way we do our business at the Public Utilities Commission, as well as how we regulate others. So if any thing positive at all comes out of all this, I think it is a new look at safety, which just has to be number one priority of the Public Utilities Commission, very frankly. I don't know if you want to make any comment on that at this moment, Mr. Clannon. As I said, he's been deeply involved, and we're expecting tomorrow what?
So tomorrow, PG&E files the results of a 2-month, very in-depth, I think unprecedentedly in-depth, look at all the records they've got of all of their pipelines. This is the one that you've been reading about in the paper that involves garages of contractors who worked on things from the 1950s and spreading the records out in the Cow Palace. We need to do that because in order to know
the Cow Palace, if you know the size of the Cow Palace, 200 people going through this.
That's right. We need to know that because in order to set the safe operating pressure of a pipeline, unless you are absolutely certain you know what's buried there under the ground, you can't be certain of the safe operating pressure. And given what we've now found out about at least one fairly egregious error in what PG&E thought it had underground, we need to know absolutely everything we can know about those pipelines. So we're going to find that out tomorrow, and then you can look for immediate action if we need to take any immediate action to make sure that those pipelines are operated safely. And then over the medium term, kind of the rest of this year and onward, you can look to the commissioners to be making some tough decisions about testing of those pipelines, installation of new kinds of valves, possibly even replacing some pipelines. So as President Peavy says, if anything good is going to come out of this, it's a new way of looking at pipeline safety, frankly, not just in California, but I'm expecting the decisions that we make here to be the industry leader for regulation of this area all across the country. And I think we're gonna see a good partnership between the National Transportation Safety Board, the federal regulators, and us. And there's certainly lots to talk about in this area, but that's an introduction anyhow.
You might just mention that we have reduced the pressure in all the major pipelines that we think warrant it.
Yeah, we've now issued three orders, beginning with the explosion, beginning within about 72 hours of the explosion, for PG&E to lower the pressure, first of all, on pipelines that were near the one that ruptured and connected to it. Then in sort of successive waves, as we learned more from the National Transportation Safety Board investigation about the kind of pipe and the kind of concern that we might have, we expanded that pressure reduction order to include the pipelines that PG&E has that are of similar vintage and that have some other characteristics in common with the one that ruptured. We're doing that not because we know that there's a defect underground, but because we don't know that there isn't. And thing number one is it has to be operating those pipelines safely. And I think you'll see that kind of prudent decision making go forward with the information that we get tomorrow as well.
So that's kind of an overview of energy issues over the past year. I'm happy to pause at this point if you'd like to ask questions in this arena, or go on to some of our other major areas like communications.
Yeah. If any members have questions at this time, I would allow you to ask them. If not, we'll continue on. Okay.
Okay. Maybe we come back. In the communications area, of course, is one that receives a good bit of attention, although not nearly as much as energy does, in all candor. And we have been very busy implementing the DFCA legislation that the former Speaker of this House, Fabio Nunez, was the author of a few years back. We have issued over 128 video franchises to 25 different companies, and both AT&T and Verizon, as an example, more than quadrupled the number of households offering video over the last 3 years. So that's a rather remarkable indication of the transformation of what was once a fairly staid old business of landlines into an incredibly creative wireline, a wireless industry with video and all the other things that are going on. We're spending a lot of time at the Public Utilities Commission because of statutory changes and requirements here in the area of broadband, trying to make sure that everybody that wants broadband gets broadband, whether they're an Indian tribe in far northern California, where they're impoverished in south central or east Los Angeles, that they have an opportunity to do it. We have received close to $8 million from the federal government under the Stimulus Money or Recovery Act to collect data on broadband availability. We'll be having the maps showing this out very, very soon. Broadband deployment is increasing. The commission created the California Emerging Technology Fund, and the legislature created the California Advanced Services Fund, which is a program that incentivizes broadband programs all over the state of California. We've spent $58 million of approximately $200 million now that has been authorized for that. And in addition, Senator Padilla has authored a bill creating a broadband council, a permanent entity in state law that includes a member of in fact, the chair of this committee, the chair of the comparable committee in the Senate, and representatives of all the major state agencies. And by statute, I chair that. We had our first meeting a week ago today, I guess it was, or 2 weeks ago today. And I chair that committee and our council. And its charge, working with our Advanced Services Fund program and with some staffing from the Public Utilities Commission, is to further ensure the spread of broadband services to everybody that needs and desires it, not just schools, but individuals at home and what have you in the state of California. It's an exciting program, and it's a great pleasure to work in that area. We also have a fundamental program on Lifeline, where we discount basic telephone service to an average of 1.8 million subscribers in the state of California who get Lifeline at the current Lifeline rate is $6.84 until the end of December of next year. You could see that's somewhat below the going market price for a cell phone or even a more extensive wire services that people get. We also have the California Teleconnect Fund, where we provide a 50% discount by incentives or subsidies of telecommunication internet services to schools, to libraries, to healthcare organizations, to nonprofit community-based organizations, CBOs, that is, and California community colleges. And that program increased last year by 29%. So that's, I think, a tribute to the staff of the PUC that has worked so hard on that. We're having a few challenges that we saw at the end of last year. In the last 15 days of December, the weather was inclemental, particularly in Southern California, all over the state, particularly in Southern California. Service quality was not as good as it should have been. Believe me, I'm very sensitized to that. This legislature has sensitized me to that. And we are going to ensure that AT&T and Verizon restore service. The goal is 90% restoral or restoration in 24 hours or less. That test was not made in the last part of last year, and I hope that's the only time that is the case, because I'm very conscious of the need, even though it was weather-related, and we know what incredible impacts nature can have, as we're reminded just the last few days, that we don't see that again. And staff is doing a report to me and to the other commissioners right now on that very point. I would just say we also regulate the water industry. We have 127 water companies and 13 sewer utilities that we regulate to serve about 20% of California residents, not a little under 20%. We've adopted an action plan that says we have to reduce water usage on a per capita basis by 20% over this decade that we're in, that conservation, like it is in the energy sector, in the water sector, it's the best, lowest cost of supply. If you could reduce your per capita usage, you've done a lot, and it may have to free up money to invest in other things. And that program is going very much ahead. We have now a low-income ratepayer assistance program in place. The 10 biggest water utilities that serve 95% of the water customers that we regulate, like we do in the energy area, help those people that have a problem with their bills. And I already pointed out the connection between water and energy. And that kind of, we could go on and other things. There's plenty else that we could talk about, Mr. Chairman, but I'm happy to turn it over to you and answer your questions. I do want to say one other thing, because it's something that we have talked about, you and I have talked about in the past. This commission has for several years now, going back to the legislature over 20 years ago when there was an assembly member named Gwen Moore in California, we have had an incredible effort on diversity of suppliers, diversity of workforce. This is for women-owned businesses, minority-owned businesses, disabled veterans-owned businesses. the program is just continues to be a great success. Both AT&T and Verizon surpassed the 40% mark in procurement from diverse suppliers. That's a huge achievement, 40% plus. PG&E was at 33%. SoCal Gas is at 37%. I gave you AT&T and Verizon. The laggard in all this was Edison, and even Edison was approaching 30%. So the record of responsible leadership in this area and the impact of it was tremendous. $900 million additional dollars went into diverse businesses last year over 2009, almost $1 billion. At a time of economic slowdown and impacts, it's very gratifying to me personally, and I think to all my colleagues, that combination of working with small businesses and with putting an emphasis every year on having an en banc where we have the CEOs of all the major companies come before us, that you can see the consequence of it in performance. There's no place else in this state, any other state, or the federal government that to my knowledge, has done as well. I'll just close on that note for the moment.
Thank you, Mr. President. Again, I'm going to open it up for my colleagues. Mr. Swanson.
Yes, thank you, President Peavy. So why is it? Is it because the utilities are dedicating staff and time to that interaction with these businesses?
You mean why are they doing so well?
Yes.
Well, the state put us on this course 20 years ago with some legislation in Glenmore passed, and then we adopted what's called General Order 156. But I have to say that the program languished for some years. There's nothing better than a bloody pulpit to incentivize people. And there are organizations like Greenlighting and others that put out annual scorecards of how the companies do, give some an A, some a B, and so forth. And nobody likes to get the lower grades, the incompletes or the D's or F's. We have annually, the commission has the CEOs of the major companies, including the Cal-Am, which has done a wonderful job in the water sector, come before us and tell us what they're doing in the areas of finance, in the areas of accounting, the areas of law, and so forth. And I guess you could say that we incentivize good behavior.
Well, I know the chairman has raised questions about the challenges facing green industries and technology. And so I would imagine that some credit, though, has to be given to the companies themselves in terms of their interest in moving this forward, for it to happen. It can't just be the threat of
No, of course not. I wouldn't want to imply that they're not good people at every company. Yeah. There are people at every major company that are really dedicated to this. And it's just that we help their job make their jobs easier. Yeah. That's about what it comes down to.
Yeah. I think there's probably in a closer look, I think that there are probably best practices that can be shared, because there are some other industries that have been slow to respond to this effort of diversity. And so my hope is that we can look at some of these best practices that some of these companies have engaged in to help us understand the best practices. And it would help other industries, particularly those that are industries that are currently being grown in the state of California, some green industries that we think have been challenged on this question of diversity. So I want to at least give credit where credit is due, but also recognize that there's a need for us to look at best practices that many of these companies can share with us.
I think that's absolutely true, and we have done that at the national level through the National Association of Utility Commissioners, and now we're engaged in working with the new state insurance commissioner, a former colleague of yours, Mr. Jones, in looking at the insurance industry, and not that we regulate the insurance industry, he does, but taking maybe some of the best practices as evidenced by the companies I've mentioned under our purview. and applying that into a different industry.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Members? All right, Mr. President, I have a few questions. And let me start with Renewable Portfolio Standard, RPS. And I guess after hearing the bill again today in Assembly Appropriations, one of the things that continues to be spoke on, and I need to give Senator Simidian great credit, is the off-ramps as it relates to ratepayer protection. But we all know most of that responsibility of overseeing that's going to fall on the shoulders of the PUC. And Senator Simidian was very clear that there are off-ramps if power is not available, if they're not access, do not have access to this renewable energy. But what if the power is not needed? And I'm not hearing anyone talk about the fact that if a utility, be it public or investor-owned, does not need to acquire or purchase at that time, will they be penalized for not doing so?
No, they wouldn't be penalized. But we set a goal now in the legislation, making way through the legislature, but the administration, the previous administration, already set it administratively of 33% by 2020. Big challenge is to make sure that we can achieve that all hours of the day. Now, there are times that perhaps you don't need a little bit of the wind power. But the more consequential thing is that other generation will back down to be replaced by renewables. Let's take something we don't regulate ourselves directly, but the city of Los Angeles gets close to 45% of its power from coal, and that coal comes from Utah. To the extent that this makes it dramatic, to the extent that the more renewables they have, the less coal they need to have, and it can be sold elsewhere or even ultimately perhaps not used at all.
So what is the PUC's vision for ratepayer protection as we move toward this 33%? How do you see yourself achieving that? Because truly understanding the bill, understanding its great intent and what it's trying to achieve here, but when it really boils down to it, it seems like it's a purchase mandate that's very narrow in scope, and understanding that wind and solar are far more higher than what we're paying right now. How do we just make sure that, because that's the biggest concern that I hear from constituents, be it residents or business, that they know a price spike is going to come.
Well, I would hope a price spike doesn't come, and it's our challenge to try to moderate the rate impacts to keep it within, as I've indicated, and on page 6 I referenced it earlier, price increases to more or less a trend line equal to the cost of living or the consumer price index. But I do think that implicit in what you're saying is it's incumbent on us, now that we seem to have got to the point that there is a tremendous amount of potential renewable generation, to be more selective than perhaps we have been in the past in terms of price. And we don't have to accept every contract. And some contracts that come forward are, we have tossed out a couple, but we have not tossed out them anywhere near what some would say we ought to do. And I'm not saying we ought to do that, because I'm very much in favor of going to 33%. In fact, I think this state can go to 40% renewables by 2020, because it's a function of reducing your demand through energy efficiency and increasing your supply of renewables. But we have to be conscious of the price. We don't want to have some huge spikes. I fully agree with that. Even though we have programs to ameliorate those spikes on low-income people and all, still it's not a wise decision. It affects the state's competitive position economically and so forth. So we want to try to alleviate or ameliorate price impacts that are untowardward and up in a lot of upward pressure.
And how difficult or easy do you see for the PUC to implement the declining TRECs as it relates to the provisions and Mr. Simidian's bill, the allowances that are going to be made for?
We'd have to work that out. That's not a simple answer. That whole TRECs
but
issue all last year drove us nuts. And we finally resolved it with a decision in January. Then along comes legislation that impacts it. And how that legislation impacts what we have just done is going to take a little bit of time to resolve effectively.
As we say, the devil's in the details.
The devil is always in the
okay.
details.
Okay. And as far as workforce development, again, we're constantly hearing the number of jobs that are going to be created by going to 33%. But as we have had discussions, it seemed like we would have seen a major uptick of jobs when we went from 0 to 20% or the alleged 20% or quickly approaching 20%. And it would be clear and evident on where that growth would be. But it seems like the future jobs are on the come from going from 20 to 33. Can you give a number of jobs and how we're going to deal with a diverse workforce, as you were just talking about? Because it seems like it's absent in these two areas, of be it wind and solar.
Well, those are two questions, at least two questions, and they're implied in what Assemblymember Swanson alluded to earlier, too, in the green side of wind and solar. And I would like very much on that to see the utilities with some prompting perhaps from the commission to be as resolute in their interest in that area of workforce development in wind and solar and other biomass and so forth as they have been in their own employment. And that's something I think that will evolve, because, yes, we want to see these jobs spread out. I cannot give you an exact a number of how many jobs have been created, but obviously there's a lot of work that's been created in the solar industry. All up and down this state, we've got new companies coming into San Diego as an example. All the time you read about it in the press, creating new manufacturing facilities. I have a fuel cell company that went from 10 employees a few years ago to 900 employees. I mean, so we're creating thousands upon thousands of jobs, tens of thousands of jobs. We know we've created in the energy efficiency area up to 18,000 new jobs just by people doing retrofits of homes and cleaning up. This is the future, and we have to be mindful of making sure that the benefits are distributed more equitably than they have perhaps been in the past for the whole workforce.
And I have a question as it relates to the Oakley Power Plant. We discussed this issue last year in the Assembly, and I know the PUC's original vote was a denial of that, and the administrative law judge supported that position, and then shortly thereafter the position was changed. And I'm just trying to find out what that justification was, because the administrative law judge clearly stated that there was no need for additional generation for that area or California. So I'm just wondering what happened in that short period of time to change that decision.
I was persuaded that we needed it. I was persuaded we needed it. The first time we took a look at this, it was a very close decision as to whether Oakley ought to go forward or not. Oakley offers some brand new, very exciting technology for a combined cycle gas turbine plant, lowest heat rate of any facility around. It had tremendous support from the community. There's people as diverse as one of your members up sitting here, and several Congress members from the area who managed to call and evidence their interest in the project. Tremendous amount of support from the building trades and the IBEW and many, many others. But at the end of the day, we all, in approving it the second go-around, not the first, the second, we extended the time out a couple of years so that the need question would be less relevant. That's about the size of it all. Of course, you're right. Administrative law judge recommended differently. But that's why we're commissioners, and they're administrative law judges.
So I guess I'm going to go along those same lines of a decision as it relates to energy efficiency bonuses to the utilities. And again, the administrative law judge, as well as staff and consultant, felt that the utilities fell way short of their goals set on energy efficiency, yet and still they receive their complete bonuses. And just trying to figure out, again, the justification for rewarding companies for failure to meet their targets.
Well, that is a fair question. I would say that the majority of the commission, remember, I'm one, there are four others, felt that they did meet their targets, and they didn't get everything that they sought, but they did get a reward because that was the way the program was set up. And there was a feeling by some commissioners that for whatever reason, the goalposts had gotten moved after they got underway in the program, and they were deserving of it. The fundamental, though, I mean, just so I don't want to let this go by here. The fundamental is, do you believe in incentivizing people to perform, or do you believe in using a stick? And I'll be very clear, my preference is to try to incentivize people and use a carrot to get performance. I think in the long term, you do much better that way than you do by trying to order people. We've tried that in the past, and you get a so-so performance.
And I agree with the carrot, but I think not rewarding is not the stick. It's just the clear fact that you haven't achieved those goals. And I think in life we all know if we haven't achieved those goals, we can't expect, be it the grade in school or raise at the job, whatever the case may be. So, and I don't think people would view that as a stick by not right. doing so. I think it's viewed by consumers that, again, people are getting paid for something that they didn't do. And at the end of the day, the consumers are continuing to subsidize these programs and these awards, and these dollars are not being spent. And I do want to commend many of the utilities for their yeoman's effort in, you know, trying to bring forth these energy efficiency programs, these diversity programs as well. But as I've always stated, you can't confuse effort with results. We believe the efforts are clearly there, but many times the results don't support all those efforts. And I would like to see the PUC, you know, hone down a little bit on making sure that we have those attainable goals that are being set forth by, be it the utilities or wherever that those goals and objectives are set, that they meet those targets. I mean, and I think that's a good signal to the consumer that the PUC, as well as this legislative body, are providing the level of oversight that really needs to be done. And I guess case in point would be, again, the telephone industry, and you alluded to it in your presentation, the outages that we experienced in December and early January by both AT&T and Verizon, and where you had customers that were somewhere out as long as 30 days. And even though we know we have GO-133C that clearly states that restore should be happening, 90% of all outages should be restored within 24 hours, both of them failed miserably at meeting those targets. How do we improve that going forward? And I know it's maybe a issue regarding workforce, but that's not the role of necessary PUC, but to make sure those targets are met, how do we achieve those?
Well, we have, in the communication areas, staff is going to come back to me very, very shortly. We're going to lay out a whole process by which that doesn't happen again, that kind of loss lengthy time before restoration that occurred in late December happens in the communication area. Back on the energy efficiency thing, I just want to say that we believe that we can verify that the savings to ratepayers for that we're not talking about the current period. We're talking about period back 2006 to 2008. That the question that you asked me was about, and who gets the savings. We think that the savings for ratepayers were $800 million. So the net benefit to ratepayers of the energy efficiency program with the incentives given to utilities was still a net $800 million. That's a pretty big number.
Anyone else with questions? I don't want to monopolize this. Mr. Huffman.
Good afternoon, Commissioner Peavy. Good to have you here. I wanted to ask you about the smart meter issue, and I hope that this isn't something you spoke to right before I walked in the room, because it's important to me, as you know, and I think you made a statement and at least appeared to signal a fairly significant policy shift, at least with respect to PG&E last week. And I wanted to ask you for a little more detail on that. As you know, I've got legislation asking utilities to develop a hardwired alternative smart meter as opposed to just wireless, and you and I have spoken a bit about this issue. Your statement seemed fairly consistent with that, but it wasn't clear as to whether you envisioned PG&E coming forward with a smart meter or just a traditional meter as part of that opt-out. And my concept has always been that nobody gets to opt out of the smart meter, but you can opt for different technology to get a smart meter.
Precisely, and that was my intent.
Okay.
Exactly that. But there are different ways to do it, and you don't have to do it through radio frequency. You could do it through a telephone line and what have you. But there is a cost inherent
sure.
to that. So, let's put this in context. PG&E has put in 7.7 million
right.
meters. 7.7 million. Edison's put in 2 million. San Diego's put in about 2 million. SMUD right here has put in hundreds of thousands. I did mention that before you came, but I didn't get into what I said last Thursday. You have provided some leadership in this. You asked the CCST, California Council of Science and Technology, to take a look at this. They did. They gave a basically clean bill of health to the smart meters. Believe me, people have come before the Public Utilities Commission have brushed that aside and said it's just that's all industry. Everything that we've looked at has been dismissed as pro this, pro that. And we get 35, 40 people that come before the Public Utilities Commission every one of our meetings now. And we let everyone speak. Not always followed in all venues, but mm-hmm. we let everybody speak. And although we try to restrict it to a minute or two, believe me, some don't. But I came to the conclusion personally that we should look at an alternative for those people that sincerely believe that they're negatively impacted, even though it's not always that clear. And I asked the president of PG&E to bring forth in 2 weeks a couple of alternative ways to do this, and that's what they've been charged
okay.
to do.
Yeah. But it does sound like you envision a hardwired smart meter as opposed to just an analog.
Well, but yes, but there's 2 points I have to make in this. First place, I'm one of 5 commissioners. I
right.
can't prejudge how others would feel about this, very frankly.
Right.
And secondly, I don't know if that is the best single answer. I want them to provide us range. But it is national policy to have a smart grid. I mean, the President of the United States has talked about this repeatedly. His Secretary of Energy, his Secretary of Commerce, they all talked about this. So we have to – you can't have a smart grid without smart meters.
Yeah, understood.
That's just the bottom line. So you can't just use the old meter.
Right.
But how we do it and how it's paid for and so forth are, I think, reasonable questions that PG&E come forward with, and then we will listen to, we'll have an order, and we'll take some action. And that will happen over the next 6 months.
I want to thank you, actually, for, I think, the sensibility that your position reflects, and I'm going to be looking with interest to see what they come forward with, and appreciate that you seem to have gotten fairly close to the same place that I am on the issue.
Well, part of the impulse came from the assembly member from Marin County, who has talked to more than once about the time. It showed an acute awareness of this, but honestly, I understand. I mean, I just have to say, I mean, I have to laugh because 9 months ago, or 6 months ago, you were so positive about the CCST, California Council of Science. This is headed by a retired chancellor at UC Santa Cruz, hardly a vet of pro-business action, right? UC Santa Cruz, and former dean of engineering of the University of California at Berkeley. And then they had the director, the person who did the exact study was the president of Humboldt State, hardly another place known for its right-wing proclivities, right? And they immediately come out with a report, and it's dismissed. It gets very frustrating. So you and I have shared some of this. I applaud your efforts in this regard, and you know, I think that we're trying to do something that makes some sense here. I have under no illusion this will satisfy everybody.
Thank you, Mr. Hoffman. President Beebe, if you don't, oh, that's fine. If you don't mind, I'm going to go back to, the telephone outage back in December and in January. And my question is, using your analogy of carrot and the stick, is there penalties or mechanisms in place for failure to achieve those outage standards currently right now by the PUC? And if not,
well, the answer is yes. We have the power to adopt and invoke penalties, yes.
But have they been adopted or invoked or used?
We have in the past fined telecommunications companies in the millions, tens of millions. As a matter of fact, we fined companies generally over the past how many years?
10 years, half a billion.
Half a billion dollars.
For slow, inadequate
service for a whole variety.
But I'm speaking more so in the service restorial area.
I can't tell you the answer to that. Maybe Mr. Lutzer can. Do you know off the top of your head? This is Jack Lutzer, the head of our communications division.
Thank you, Jack.
Come sit down.
Good afternoon. I'm Jack Lutzer, the director of the communications division at the PUC. And it has been about 7 years since we applied direct fines to the local exchange carriers for failing to meet the commission's service quality rules of the time. And in the last couple or 2 years ago, the commission adopted this incentive approach that adopted the 90% goal within 24 hours to restore service. We don't have automatic penalties to fine them if they don't meet that standard, but as President Peavy mentioned, the commission will be looking at options that might consider that in a staff report that we're going to deliver within the next week or two.
So we do have the freedom to do that, is the point.
And rate increases. We all know that rate increases for basic service has gone from $10 a month to now $20 a month through AT&T, and we've seen increases from 50% to 400% for things like call waiting, call transfer, and call forwarding. And what mechanisms are in place to keep those rates low? And again, I guess it reflects upon the number of outages and the length of those outages, but yet and still rates are going up and what can clearly be perceived service is going down. So,
well, as I indicated earlier, a basic lifeline rate is a little under $7 and will be through the end of next year. So that has not gone up at all. Some of these other services that you just, when the industry essentially was deregulated, the freedom on things like call waiting and in-home maintenance and all those things were then fees and charges that AT&T, Verizon, or who are Sure West or whomever it may be can charge on their own. We don't regulate that anymore. We gave up that regulation. We do continue to do lifeline rates, and we do have some control over basic services. And you want to augment anything I said?
Yes, President Peavy, and if I might add, staff is on a quarterly basis tracking the trends of rates for residential and small business services provided by the local exchange carriers of California, and we're also trying to expand that analysis to include wireless and other options like VoIP. And we'll be giving that information to the commissioners on a quarterly basis starting this year so that they can assess whether or not they need to relook at their competitive policy, which essentially deregulated those services.
Do you find telephony right now in California of the four largest phone providers a competitive market?
The commission has made that finding in a number of decisions over the last 3 to 5 years, and there is a proceeding before the commission now that asks the staff to look at competition and how it might be used in rulemakings to go forward to make sure that there is still competition among the local exchange carriers in the state.
To just augment that or maybe emphasize it, we are going to have what we call an order instituting rate making and rulemaking and what have you on the level, extent, and scope of competition in telecom as it exists today. We're going forward with that.
Well, Mr. Peavy, Mr. Klein, and I appreciate your candor and your answers to the questions that have been presented so far. We're going to now allow for, since I have no more questions from my colleagues from the PUC, we'll allow the Department of Ratepayer Advocacy to come forth, and I think we have Joseph Como who will be testifying now. Thank you, Mr. Peavy.
Okay.
Thank you, Chairman Bradford. I'm Joe Como, Acting Director for DRA, and I've actually brought up with me today Dave Ashukian, who is our Deputy Director for Energy Matters, and Phyllis White, who's our Deputy Director for Water and Telecommunication Matters. I've assumed the role of Acting Director since our untimely demise of our Director, Dana Appling, last August. So I've been in the job since August. There is a handout that I think you should all have, and I'll go through it very quickly. We are, as most of you already know, an independent consumer advocacy division of the PUC. We represent consumers as a group on electricity matters, natural gas, water, communications. As a matter of fact, if you look at it, we probably represent more than 99% of all customers in California in one venue or another. We have a statutory mandate in the Public Utilities Code to represent and advocate on behalf of public utility customers to obtain what it says is the lowest possible rates for utility service consistent with safe and reliable service levels. And we take that very, we don't just advocate for lowest possible rates, but lowest possible rates consistent with having a safe system, having a reliable system, and part of that is environmental awareness and trying to achieve the state's goals for energy conservation and renewable energy in the most low-cost manner possible. We're the only state entity that is charged with this mission, and I think you'll find that we're probably the largest entity in the state of California that represents basically all utility customers, at least of the independently owned utilities that that come before any forum in California. And moving on to my page four very quickly, we are funded exclusively through the Public Utilities Commission ratepayer advocacy account and not through the general fund. We basically track our success in part and how we save the ratepayers, the customers of the utilities money. We see that for every dollar that's spent on DRA, comes out to a nearly $200 savings on a typical person's utility bill. And that was for 2010. So that was, and that's a trend upward from even 2009. Our budget for DRA represents only about 0.1% of all the revenue for the California's regulated utilities, and probably even less than that when you consider that we don't really regulate rates on the big telecommunication providers in California. And our budget is unchanged from 2010. Going on to page five, what we do before the commission is that we are the developer of the record. We are the chief advocate for a lot of the PUC proceedings, and especially in areas where there may not even be other entities in the room, like a lot of our water cases. So we do auditing and analysis, investigations, discovery. We put on expert witness testimony. We provide legal briefings. We orally defend our positions. Basically, we're analyzing the utilities' costs and seeing how the policies of the state and the commission affect those costs, and we try to help the commission to shape those policies and result in the least cost effect on consumers. And we also advocate before other entities, not just the commission, before the ARB, the California Independent System Operator, the CEC, Department of Water Resources. We also participate we present testimony before the Low-Income Oversight Board and any sort of ad hoc entities that come up that we need to express the consumer's point of view. Before the legislature, which is very important to us, we participate in bill and informational hearings for many of the members. We provide technical assistance on these very complex matters, and we participate in working group meetings, again, to try to express the consumer's point of view and try to shape those policy goals. Going on to my page six, DRA, again, you know, we gauge ourselves in part in how we save customers money. We believe that we've saved customers about $5 billion, especially for residential and small business customers, who are the entities that we mostly represent. And on the communication side, President Peavy talked about the basic lifeline, basic service. Chairman Bradford, you talked about what's been done in communications. We were the entity that actually fought hardest for lifeline rates to be capped for the next 2 years, as President Peavy had said, at $6.84. And we are also fighting to have the commission look at competition for basic service rates, so that some of the assumptions that were made about whether competition will keep down rates, we advocated very hard to get the commission to open up the rate making proceeding, the OIR, the order instituting rate on that issue. And so we are sort of the chief proponents for that issue. We established strong anti-cramming rules for phone users, or at least we advocated for that, we increased our enforcement for service quality standards. We're a large advocate for the multi-line system E911 service. You know, where you have a large building and you have E911 service, you have to know, or the first responders have to know where that's coming from. Also the same thing with broadband. If you have a lot of broadband users that are getting their primary phone service from broadband, 911 service is an important component that those users need to be aware of, and the standards have to be established for that. And we've also fighting to have the state look at the deposit rules for small business energy customers, and we worked with small business groups to get them on board on dynamic pricing, to inform them about issues that will affect them so that they are knowledgeable, because they are usually customers that are have fixed cost businesses. They may not be aware of how dynamic pricing is going to affect them specifically. So we have partnered with small business organizations so that they are aware of some of that going on. Going on to my page 7, this gives a recap of how busy we are. We have 142 people within DRA that have participated in 205 CPUC proceedings. We filed 667 pleadings last year. We've advocated before those commissioners, including President Peavy, over 300 times, so we can be very annoying. We've participated in numerous informal meetings and workshops. I've already told you how we advocate before the legislature, and we have expanded on that a little bit on page 8 of my handout, where some of the larger issues that were important to the legislature in 2010, where DRA was an active participant, including the renewable portfolio standard, the issue of smart meters, greenhouse gas emissions, the cap and trade, broadband deployment, lifeline telephone service, water supply and conservation. We've been an active role player on sort of the policy around that. And so DRA has been very busy in 2010, and we're very proud of what we have done. I want to turn it over to the deputy directors now in order to tell you a little bit more about the sort of the granularity on their issues. First, Dave Ashukian will talk about our energy issues.
Yeah. On page 9, we talk about our energy accomplishments, and I consider our general rate cases to be what I consider DRA's kind of bread and butter when it comes to saving ratepayers money. Each year, that's really the lion's share of the reductions. Last year, we saved close to $3 billion in asking for reduced requests from what the utilities had asked for. PG&E's rate case is still ongoing. There was a natural gas case as well. And Pacific Corp. In energy procurement is another area. The capacity market proceeding was another big win for DRA, where we were recommending bilateral trading, which has been working for many years now. The proposal for the capacity market would have resulted in potentially up to $1 billion in additional cost to ratepayers. PG&E had a cornerstone improvement program, which, you know, we believe should have been part of a GRC. It was a request that was separate from a GRC. It was very ambiguous as to what they were going to use that money for. We pretty much much won about $1 billion reduction in that program. And another big area was in preventing low-income and utility disconnections. We produced a report in late 2009 that resulted in a proceeding that the commission created to look at options that the utilities could implement to reduce connections. We'll talk about some of the things we're doing now. We actually are about to come out with an updated report on that, which shows that disconnections have dropped. But unfortunately, the underlying problem, which is customers who are behind and in arrears of their monthly bills, has not dropped, and therefore there's still a potential problem looming in that customers may end up, again, with significant disconnections. We released a couple of reports. One we talked about to your committee last week on the CSI program and the solar trends and photovoltaics. Where we talked about how the CSI program has transformed, and we believe is transforming the market for solar PV panels. We also released a report, not listed on this presentation, on how ratepayers can fund electric vehicle infrastructure that we think in an appropriate manner that benefits those who actually are the vehicle owners, and that the non-vehicle owner ratepayers won't necessarily bear the full burden of that infrastructure program.
I hate to interrupt, but my question would be, why would they bear any burden if they're not owner of electric vehicle?
Well, there is potential benefits to the non-electric utility, electric vehicle owner that could provide essentially an offsetting of the cost. So we are looking at making sure that those ratepayers who don't own electric vehicles only pay for a program that receives benefits, essentially has a cost-benefit ratio of better than one for those ratepayers. But, yes, basically our position is the vehicle owner should bear the cost of the infrastructure improvements that are required for electric vehicles. Just moving on to some of our priorities for 2011, we're in the midst of essentially four simultaneous rate cases. This is where the utilities come in and ask for additional revenues to complete and to serve their customers. If you add all four rate cases together, it's a combined greater than $11 billion increase in what their current operations are. And some of the other areas that are ongoing, making sure that the cap and trade program that's being implemented by the Air Resources Board properly treats ratepayer funds, and making sure that those programs and the cost of that program goes back to benefiting those ratepayers. Energy efficiency goals. The commission is in the process of updating the strategic plan, and we're making some recommendations on how to continue implementing the energy efficiency programs. Smart grid is another hot topic. Certainly, we are very concerned about how customers who would be opted out, much like electric vehicle owners, making sure that the cost of that program doesn't burden potentially other ratepayers that aren't opting out. And that's a very potentially a costly program, depending on how that ends up being implemented. Along with smart grid is the dynamic rates that the commission has requested the utilities start to promulgate for starting with small business customers. We're seeing significant backlash even from the large businesses that have already been implemented. Are concerned that we're maybe moving a little too fast on implementing these dynamic rates, and such that we want to make sure that the customers get the buy-in and have the tools and information necessary so they can actually utilize the infrastructure appropriately. As I mentioned, we're finalizing a update to our disconnection report. And another major issue will be how we implement a cost containment mechanism for the Renewable Portfolio Standard bill that will be upon us very shortly.
And Deputy Director Phyllis White can talk to our water and communications accomplishments in 2010 and what we're planning in 2011.
In 2010, DRA saved water ratepayers more than $73 million through general rate case proceedings. DRA applications for the 10 largest investor-owned water utilities provide water to about 6.2 million people in California. In addition to rate case proceedings, DRA actively pursues broad policy objectives on behalf of water ratepayers. In the 2010 contamination proceeding, for example, DRA successfully convinced the commission that ratepayers should not pay for the effects of water contamination that's caused by others. In another 2010 matter, DRA successfully advocated and convinced the commission to open a rulemaking to consider water recycling policy. Our priorities for 2011 include another year of rigorous analysis and strong advocacy to ensure water ratepayers receive safe and reliable service at reliable rates. The utilities that will file in 2011 have a combined 520,000 connections and serve over 1.7 million people and represent a total revenues of about $537 million. DRA is also focused on ensuring water utility conservation programs are achieving the most conservation per dollar. And we believe that water recycling and rain recapture technologies will help address long-term needs. With regards to mergers and acquisitions, we will scrutinize proposals this year to make sure that the ratepayers are not harmed. Lastly, DRA is intent on seeing improved performance from water utilities and will be advocating for the use of best practices and benchmarks to measure and improve utility performance. On the communications side, one of our proudest accomplishments in 2010 was the work that we did in the Lifeline program. We worked with Assemblyman Fuentes on AB 2211 and with the commission to add a wireless option to the program and to ensure that Lifeline service will remain affordable to the 2 million low-income Lifeline subscribers, at least through the year 2013. We're proud also of our work to have price controls placed on residential basic service. We petitioned the commission for price controls and are pleased that the commission did open a proceeding to consider that issue. Another 2010 accomplishment of note is our advocacy for stronger cramming protections. At our urging, the commission has adopted stronger reporting and enforcement rules. And in the areas of service quality and reliability, DRA was instrumental in shaping standards and metrics for improved customer service. Lastly, with regard to the $225 million California Advanced Services Broadband Fund, we worked with the legislature to have the commission revisit policies to better maximize public interest. We have five policy priorities for the year 2011. We will continue to advocate for price controls on residential basic service. With regard to the Lifeline program, we will participate in the commission forums to implement the wireless option. With regard to broadband, DRA is in full support of the legislature and the commission's goals. But we moreover advocate for prioritizing broadband funding to underserved, inner city, low income, and minority neighborhoods. In the area of customer protections, we will be looking for geographic and demographic trends, such as providers targeting less robust service to rural or less wealthy, or possibly to limited English proficiency populations. And we will pursue first-party crammers. That's when the telephone companies themselves place fraudulent charges on their customer bills. In the area of public safety, we are participating in the Commission's multi-line telephone standards working group. And generally, DRA will continue to advocate for matters of emergency communications to be resolved effectively and for the cost to be borne by ratepayers to be reasonable.
We have included a few pages of just DRA facts for your edification. I won't go into those there here. Some a little more detail. I also forgot to mention that we also have with us today Cheryl Cox, our policy advisor, and Matthew Marcus, who's our legislative director. Many of your offices already know Matthew as being the face of DRA in Sacramento. So we're open to any questions that members may have.
Members, anyone have any questions at this time? Mr. Hernandez.
Thank you, Chairman Bradford. Thank you for being here. Your role is a very important one, and one I'm sure that ratepayers across the state are hopeful that you're always very successful at. In your auditing and analysis role, please give me a little bit more insight about some of these grant funding opportunities that have been provided to, public utilities, private or publicly owned, where they haven't met their, their goals, where they haven't met their, their renewable goals, but yet they've received, whether it was it $80 million to,
it's the energy efficiency,
their efficiency goals. And there wasn't a meeting of the, of the goals, but yet the grants continue to move forward. Can you tell me, can you opine on that? What's going on with that?
Well, boy, that's a loaded question. It's an issue that DRA has taken issue with for many years now. The energy efficiency goals that were set up were done with, as you know, with an opportunity for utilities to earn an incentive if they met those goals. But what was also established are the metrics for meeting those goals. And as Assembly Member Bradford had pointed out, those metrics were not met, and the energy, the Public Utilities Commission had determined many years ago that that its own staff would make sure that the metrics were followed, that there was a lot of money being allocated for the purpose of measuring whether goals were achieved. And when the energy division, in this case, which is part of the commission, had determined independently, with they don't have a stake in this fight, that the goals were not met, then we take issue or take umbrage with the fact that the commission would ignore its own staff report in this area. So we don't feel that the incentives should have been paid out, as we have said many times in our briefs and our statements, that where the goals were not met, they should not be paid out. Okay. And then secondarily to that, we seem to be stuck with not moving the goalpost in terms of what those programs should be doing in terms of market transformation. And we have opined in that area that we need to have a more robust program followed that gets us to better energy efficiency savings through harder to reach measures, that when we get market transformation in terms of light bulbs, for instance, that we acknowledge that, and then we move on to the harder issues like retrofitting whole houses with better energy efficiency programs and businesses. You want to elaborate more on that, Dave?
Well, I would just use a similar response that President Peavy used, is that we were not convinced that the energy efficiency program's goals were met, and that we again advocated that they not receive those incentives. And obviously, we are not in a position of authority, and so therefore, our position wasn't agreed with by the commission. But in fact, as Joe says, there was evidence, there was data, there was an analysis done. We spent $100 million doing an independent analysis of the ability or the metrics to achieve those goals. That analysis showed that that those goals were not met.
The commission spent that $100 million, not DRA.
Correct. Right. And even with that information, it was discounted and it was approved. So,
when it was discounted, did they speak to why they were discounting your recommendations and advice? Did they speak to that?
There was some language in the decision that basically said that there was some disagreement over what the information was in the report, and in fact that there was some early gains, and essentially that they just essentially felt like they should get that incentive level.
And then just a follow-up question relating to, again, your role as advocates as it relates to auditing and analysis. And I do apologize if any of the committee members have already asked this question of PUC Chairman Peavy. I've been running in and out of committees. But as it relates to DFCA, I've been hearing from parties on all sides as it relates to analysis of their promise, commitments made from the purveyors of this of the cable industry and entering the industry. One of the promises spoke to workforce development, and that was a big selling point for the legislature. I wanted to see if I, again, on behalf of consumers, have you had a chance to analyze job growth in this area? Has workforce widened? Has it expanded here in California? I know that's on a very broader social level. People are going more to the cell phones and leaving the landlines, but ultimately, what's kind of the net gain in terms of California jobs? Are we seeing a displacement of California-based jobs? Is this something that you guys are monitoring? Is there any information that you could provide as it relates to DFCA? And to be more specific, if as you answer that bigger question, a more specific question I'd like to ask is, you know, a lot of the statements that are being made to me in my office is speak to accuracy and timeliness of reporting on the part of PUC as they speak to requirements being met. Can you speak to that?
Well, I can say that the reporting that was supposed to come has not yet been released on DFCA. DRA is waiting for that report that was required under the legislation. We haven't seen it. So we have not yet been able to analyze the information that you're asking for.
Is that for this year or any information ever?
Well, there's been certain information, but there's some information that was required, a report that was required, and we haven't seen that yet. There have been others, but not the one that is going to give us some of the details that you're asking for.
But let me ask you about the previous years that you have seen. Can you speak to the information there in terms of the question at hand, accuracy, timeliness? Has that been factors that you've considered? Has that been areas of concern?
It has not been an area of concern. The reports have been issued, and we have not had a concern about those reports. And in terms of the accuracy, we haven't audited, so we are taking it at face value, the data that's in there.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hernandez. Mr. Valadao.
On slide 4, you've actually got numbers here where you say for every dollar customer spent, they've saved nearly $200 on their utility bills. Where do you get those numbers, and how have you verified them?
Want me to take that?
Yeah, go ahead.
We basically look at what we believe are the decisions that the PUC has made that are in favor of our positions that we have advocated for. We have done our best to not identify things that, you know, we believe aren't as a result of our specific advocate, you know, our specific position. When we add up all the various programs, for example, when the commission denied the PG&E Cornerstone program of a close to $1 billion, we had each one of those decisions up. We got to somewhere a little above $5 billion in total reductions in requests for approval. And we take that $5 billion, we divide it by our personal budget, which is in the $28 million range. We end up with about $200 for every dollar spent on our budget.
Let's point out, we've got it here on page 9. In terms of the detail, some of the details on page 9 is some of the accounting that adds up to that $5 billion.
No, I saw those numbers. I just wasn't sure if there's anybody had verified that or independent verification, anybody else, or just internal?
Just internal.
Okay. Thank you.
Again, you could, you know, obviously one could argue which decisions were, you know, solely because of DRA versus, you know, other influences.
Any more questions? Okay, I have one as it relates to telecommunications again, and there was a little bit of discussion earlier with the PUC as it related to the outages that were experienced in AT&T and Verizon service territories over the holiday. And my question again here is, President Peavy talked about the carrot and the stick. At what point does fines need to be implemented in order to change behavior, or what do you suggest as a better use of ratepayers' dollars when infrastructure is not being maintained, i.e. the copper in the ground, and which will have a long-term effect on trying to implement the broadband and all these other programs and initiatives that we have that we're currently collecting funds for. So can you elaborate on that a little bit for me?
Yeah, maybe make Steve, and you can follow up on it, Phyllis. We have for many years now been advocating for standards for service quality, of which in part I would say have fallen on deaf ears. And so we're hoping that
deaf ears by the PUC.
That's okay. Correct. All right. We have been advocating for copper wire to be remaining in place because it offers competition for telephone providers at the local level, and it offers a incentive to broadband providers to do a better job at providing services that they need to provide. So the broadband service quality issues are something that we have been advocating and basically is a mantra from us going back several years now. But that being said, we're seeing a lot of sort of the light coming on now because we're very happy with some of the choices and new commissioners. Commissioner Sandoval, we believe, has a record for supporting customer interests in these areas. And so we do believe that some of the things that DRA has been advocating in the past will fall in line in terms of the commission's priorities, because we've already seen some of that in terms of cramming and in terms of looking at competition in the wireline industry. So we do believe that we will see more attention being paid to service quality. In terms of fines, where they should be levied, we absolutely believe that they should be where they need to be levied. You commented earlier that effort shouldn't be shouldn't confuse effort with results. If they're not meeting the results, then that is what we should be looking at. And so in terms of telecommunications, we have less vision in terms of what's going on because it's not a cost of service industry anymore. So we cannot see inside the companies and point to what they're doing right and what they're doing wrong. So we have limited ability to do that, but we can try to convince the commission to set up very, you know, maybe not stringent is not the right word, but very well-defined goals, very easily measured goals that the telecommunications industry should follow. And that's the kind of things that we've been advocating for.
Yeah, I want to just echo what Joe said, that fines and performance measures are good incentives for companies to deliver good performance, good service for their customers. In addition, the commission needs to enforce the rules that it has. The commission does have certain service quality rules on its books. It needs to enforce them, and DRA also is advocating that the commission publicize, put on its website, information about complaint data, about the achievement of performance metrics. One of the logic for deregulating the companies was that that customers would walk with their feet, but customers need information in order to make decisions, good decisions about where they want to put their communications dollar. The commission has information and it should make it public. It should put it on its website, and it should make update the information on a quarterly basis so that it remains current.
Thank you. As we talk about ratepayer protection and cost containment, let's talk a little bit about RPS. I'm curious on what DRA is doing in that regard to ensure that ratepayer protection is at the forefront of moving into this new direction.
Sure. Well, certainly one of the things that we have been doing is trying to sunshine some of the data that has been, you know, available to the confidential side of the utility, including DRA. We produced a report called the Green Rush that talked about, you know, the fact that we have essentially blown past the above market fund mechanism that was created under the original RPS program. And so we are looking at making sure that there is essentially more focus on the issue of cost. Certainly, it's been a primary issue with the adoption of 33%. For the last few years, DRA has advocated for transparency in those costs, for total cost reporting. Again, just procuring the energy side of renewables is only a portion of the cost. When it comes to a renewable program, the utility has to procure transmission. It has to procure backup generation that will back up the intermittent, non-dispatchable type of renewables. Those are all costs that are associated with the requirement of 33%. So we have been, again, advocating to make sure that all those costs are sunshined. Certainly, again, the fact that the original cost containment mechanism, which was very detailed in establishing a market price referent, determining how much should be afforded for each utility, was essentially ignored. And so we believe that we have to be even more vigilant now with the new legislation, because there is no language that describes the detailed mechanism, but just says establish a mechanism. We heard President Peavy say that we hope that we could do this within the cost of living adjustment increases, or consumer price index. We would certainly love that would be the case, but again, the proof will be in the pudding when it comes to how the commission implements a process to make sure that those rates don't are adversely impacted.
Thank you, Mr. Fong.
Well, thank you for your work in ratepayer protection. You provide the consumers a great deal of confidence, and the energy accomplishments for 2010. On the bottom, it says preventing disconnections, savings of $119 million. Is that the reinstatement fee?
There's a bunch of the utilities. When we established some programs to reduce disconnections, the utilities had additional costs that they were asking the commission to approve. Some of that was probably disconnection fees, and even just the cost of expanded programs. The commission denied those additional fees at our advocacy, and that's the number that we're reporting there.
Well, thank you for your work on that one.
And I just want to go back to broadband, and you stated that there could be a greater effort made in expending those funds, or by the utilities making these funds making the community aware of these programs that exists, especially in the urban and underserved areas. Can you elaborate on some of the things that they're not doing that maybe they possibly could do to help promote a better take rate of broadband in those underserved communities?
The commission's program is the CASF, the California Advanced Services Fund program. And that program essentially has been doling out money to, as it were, all comers. The commission thought that there would be competition for the funds. As it turns out, I think there's been no competition for in any area that the commission has authorized broadband monies. So they fund projects without concern of the cost of the projects, without the public having any knowledge of it until it shows up on the commission agenda, and then some information is not privy to the public. DRA is able to get it, but we can't use it in our comments, the information we have. So we know that the cost of some of these projects vary from a couple hundred dollars per project to several thousand dollars. We would like to see the commission use adoption as one of the measures for awarding projects. Right now, it's essentially whoever asks for it can get it, basically. We would like the commission to require that there's some commitment to the residents in the area that the price will be affordable, because it doesn't help to build the project if no one can afford it once it's built. We would like, it's public money. We would like for there be a requirement and a commitment that the access to the project will be affordable to the residents in the area. And target extra points for projects that would go into low-income, inner-city, urban areas.
Thank you, Ms. Buchanan.
I'd just like to follow up. So are most of these projects from the Advanced Services Fund, are they in rural areas or inner-city areas?
They tend to be in rural areas at
right.
this point.
And so, and part of the problem in rural areas is that it's very costly to get the service to them, which means a lot of, mm-hmm. you know, I can see why there's less competition, because you're not, you know, you don't have people who want to go in mm-hmm. to a market that is very limited. So don't we have, in essence, don't we have two problems? One is, how do we get the service to these areas? Because if you don't get service to them, it doesn't matter what the price is. And then the second one is, how can we make price reasonable? And if you have just the small carriers that want to go into those areas, it seems to me like I don't know how you solve that problem, but maybe you can comment on that.
Well, every technology is not for every area. It may be that it's not a wired solution in a rural area. It's very likely that a wireless solution or some other technology would be better use. The commission could reach out to some other. Most of the projects now are wired projects. So,
but regardless of whether it's wired or wireless, it's going to be more expensive per user, simply because you're serving limited populations.
Exactly.
And I don't know what the answer is to that, but. You know, other than having some kind of subsidized rates or whatever, but you know, it's when you have very limited markets, and you know, we've talked about this before. It's very hard to find people who are willing to go in and serve, whether they're doing the wired or whether they're doing the wireless. And without it, you know, not having access to the internet and those other services in today's society can have a profound impact, from whether you're looking for a job to purchasing goods or trying to just access information.
That's right. And, of course, cost is only one factor. There are many other factors that would be considered in the awarding of projects. If public money that's being used, DRA's position is that we want to maximize the public good. There should be a requirement for open access, for example. There is none now, but we think that there should be. There should be requirements that the price for access should be lower, you know, as low as feasible, because it's public money. This is not a private investment where one can expect a return, a higher return, but for the risk that you mentioned. But using public monies, we should maximize the public benefit.
I would echo that, too, and I just had opportunity this weekend to participate in a community forum hosted by one of the utilities, and they were doing a great job, but the reoccurring theme, I should say, was the fact that the corporation was spending this money, the utility was spending this money, and I had to step up quickly and state, no, that's the ratepayers' money, and it should be doled out in a more responsive and a more effective manner than what I see now. And I think that's my greatest concern, whether it be energy efficiency and promoting light bulbs that we now find out that have mercury in them, and now we have a disposable issue with CFLs. I mean, all of those things that at the onset sound real great and we all embrace and we encourage, but at the end of the day, not everyone gets a chance to participate in. So whether it be the diversity, outreach, and all this. My question, I had a question for you guys as it relates to rate-making proceedings, I should say. At what point should shareholder dollars be used versus ratepayer dollars as it relates to investment and infrastructure by utilities? And it's been a ongoing debate, especially in light of the San Bruno explosion, that instead of using ratepayer dollars to repair that infrastructure or maintain that infrastructure, that shareholder dollars would be used. Has there been any discussion of changing the rate making procedures and what percentage or how that formula is allocated?
That's certainly going to be a topic for the proceeding that's going on right now in establishing the next, a new safety-related procedures for the utilities. Certainly, our position is, ratepayers paid for what they thought was a safe and reliable system already. And then certainly if it's determined that there was, in fact, negligence or improperly done work that we already paid for, that should not come from the ratepayers again. But certainly, in general, when it comes to shareholder versus ratepayer dollars, we have to look at risk. Is what the utility's asking for, is there a risk that this will not come to fruition or that ratepayers will end up paying more than we thought they would? We generally find that if we have some tie-in to shareholder money, we find that the utilities are much more careful in discriminating how they spend their shareholder money compared to how they spend ratepayer money. There's a number of activities that they say, let's have ratepayers pay for this, and oftentimes we don't see the connection as to how that expenditure ties back to safe and reliable service to the utility, to the ratepayer.
Yeah, I would add just a point to that in terms of the there is, as you probably know, a natural gas order instituting rate-making proceeding going on right now where we, DRA, will play a very active role. And those issues have been teed up there that, where the split is between what the shareholder pays in the area of upgrading the gas system to make it as safe and reliable as we all thought it was will be a factor in determining where we fall on who pays for what.
I want to thank you, but before you leave, I have a question that might not be directly related to consumer protection and ratepayer advocacy, but there might be a slight nexus. Did DRA have any opinion as it relates to the PUC Foundation and how that is being funded, and does it create a big enough firewall for the PUC to be objective in, monitoring, assessing fines, benefits as it relates to bonuses? Do you think that relationship is clouded in any way based on the foundation?
I'm not sure yet. I mean, it depends on what the foundation does. So far, it's not been transparent to me what they are doing. I've read the bylaws and read the articles of incorporation, and leads me to believe that there might be a perception of conflict, although it's unclear whether there's a direct direct conflict. Personally, I don't think I would have called it the CPUC Foundation, for instance. But if its primary goal is to provide education, it depends on what form that education takes. We already fund the utilities to provide education with regard to their programs that the commission has authorized, for instance, demand response or energy efficiency or smart meters. There's already monies approved for them to educate the consumer so that the consumer is not caught unaware. If it's supposed to substitute for that, then I would say that it's probably not necessary to do that, because the commission should have, the utilities already have the money to do that. So it's unclear.
And are those funds, and you might not know the answer, ratepayer dollars or shareholder dollars that goes into the foundation?
Definitely ratepayer dollars.
Okay. All right. I want to thank you guys for your testimony today. And if you're going to stay around, I just want to give opportunity for public comment. If there are folks in the audience who are part of public comment, I would love for you to come up before we adjourn. So, and if you mind standing around, we'll, if there's any additional questions based on what the public has to say. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Rochelle Becker, and I'm the Executive Director of the Alliance for Nuclear Responsibility, and we represent ratepayers on this side of the Pacific Rim. Before I start, is it possible, I know we're in a budget crisis, but can I have a glass of water? I've been doing interviews with media since Friday morning, and I would need a drink of water. Thank you. That's perfect. Thank you very much. The Public Utilities Commission currently has before it PG&E's application for ratepayer funding to renew the license for the Diablo Canyon Nuclear Power Plant. I did not notice anyone from the PUC mention this today in all of the things that they are doing in 2010, but this case is before them. This committee, the legislature, the California Energy Commission, and the California Coastal Commission have all directed both PG&E and Southern California Edison to complete all AB 1632 seismic studies and updated 3D reflection mappings before any decision to rely on these aging and seismically vulnerable plants. AB 1632 began in this committee. It began in this committee with my Republican Assemblyman Sam Blakesley, a PhD in seismology. We would like to make sure that this committee continues its actions if at all possible and oversees what is happening. The PUC has itself written to the utilities and told them it cannot make a prudent decision about full development of the AB 1632 issues until the seismic studies are complete. Will the legislature responsible for AB 1632's request that the PUC return PG&E's application for license renewal until the seismic studies requested under AB 1632 are completed and independently reviewed? We also heard quite a bit today about studies being done by the utilities but not being reviewed and having that to be a problem in the future. 10 hours before the Japanese earthquake, I sent some questions to the committees hoping that you would ask some questions on what's happening on the seismic studies, the aging reactors, and the radioactive waste that will be stored on site on our coast for 60 years after the last kilowatt flows from these plants. Nobody asked the question, so here I am hoping that you will ask it in the future. This is very important. The nuclear power plants in Japan stopped functioning when the earthquake began. They closed down. However, they cannot continue to cool these plants. There are 4 active earthquake faults within 5 kilometers of Diablo Canyon. What this legislature has done is said, we think there's even more earthquake faults out there. I asked the Nuclear Regulatory Commission last month, I'm looking at PG&E's slide, it's saying that we have 4 active faults within 5 kilometers, one less than 2.5 miles away, one 1,800 feet away. And I asked them, well, how many faults does it take before we decide that this isn't the best place to operate nuclear reactors? Is it 5 earthquake faults? Is it 6 earthquake faults? And they looked at me like I was speaking, pardon the pun, Japanese. They didn't answer me. They don't have a number of earthquake faults it takes. This plant, when it received the Certificate of Public Convenience and Necessity in 1967, knew of no earthquake faults within 50 miles. When it received an operating license in the mid-1980s, they knew about 1 earthquake fault.
I really don't want to end your testimony, but the focus of this testimony and your concerns are valid, very valid, and that's why I'm pained to interrupt you. But what we were here today is to look at a year in review as it relates to the PUC.
Okay.
And much of what you're speaking of today is the result of what happened this past weekend, a tragedy in Japan, and we're all sensitive to that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm pretty sure it will be discussions that will be teed up going forward. But as we sit here today, we're really trying to do a year in review as it relates to what the PUC has done, hasn't done, and what we can improve on. So this is probably one of those things of that review of Mr. Blakesley's bill and those standards. So on that note, I just want to
Go back to the year in review. This legislature, the Energy Commission and the Coastal Commission, ask Pacific Gas and Electric Company to do seismic studies before it applied for license renewal. PG&E applied anyway, and then they went to the California Public Utilities Commission last year, 2010, and they asked for two different things in two different proceedings. One was the funding to do the seismic studies. We didn't oppose the funding. We want these seismic studies done and completed and reviewed as quickly as possible. The PUC did pass the funding for the license for the seismic studies in August. However, the license renewal application, we have had to file testimony. We have had to file comments, rebuttal testimony. And the PUC has, Mr. Peavy himself sent a letter to the head of Edison and PG&E and told them that they needed to complete these seismic studies before the commission could make a responsible decision. Why they didn't take the application, notice that the seismic studies aren't done, and hand it back to them rather than waste the public's time, the DRA's time, the consumer advocate's time for a year to say, gee, can you prove they should do these seismic studies? You told them they should do the seismic studies. The Energy Commission, the Coastal Commission told them they should do the seismic studies. And did it take the tragedy that's happening in Japan to make them return this application? I don't know what more it could take. That is my statement to you. This has been going on for many, many years. The PUC has not reviewed the seismic studies in the past when they licensed this plant, and there was a $4 billion cost overrun. What is it going to cost California when it has no money whatsoever? We need to look very seriously about 4,000 megawatts that sit on our coast. If we have to turn them off, we have to turn them off. The Japanese would love to only have 4,000 megawatts missing. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Our next individual, again, state your name and your organization. And
My name is Dan Santos, and I'm an employee of AT&T and also a local officer for Communication Workers of America. And I have some questions that I can submit, which I would have liked to have seen perhaps President Peavy respond to. And one of those is that the PUC is charged with enforcing the legal mandate of consumer protection, specifically providing equitable resolution of consumer complaints. And, you know, I've been reading about the Consumer Affairs Branch, and I know that their staffing has been up and down, and that they have fielded over 100,000 complaints just in the last year. And I'd like to know the status of those complaints, the status of that branch of the PUC as far as staffing, and whether the public is made aware of their right to complain over the quality of service. I don't believe that's the case, and we know for a fact from a study that was done just last year that the CAB just kind of arbitrarily closed thousands of cases somewhere between 2006 and 2007 without even reporting any results or any follow-up. So we'd like to know if that's if that could ever happen again, or if there's any really thoughtful work being done regarding consumers' complaints. Also, there were 2 million low-income Californians receiving services under the subsidized lifeline rate. Well, now I'm receiving some good news, which is that apparently they're going to continue through the end of the year, but then there will still be some impacts on them over the long term. Service quality measurements in California, I don't believe that they're strict enough, and I also highly doubt the reports. But one report that I do have would indicate that AT&T was at 50% of the repair tickets restoral. 90% of repair tickets should be restored within 24 hours. They were at or below 50% for over 6 months of the year. And that was before these storms, which were described as of biblical proportions, hit. So they were already not meeting those, and yet there have been no consequences, and now I wonder whether they ever met them. And I found it kind of surprised when President Peavy said, yeah, they've kind of missed the mark a few times, but I don't think that's always the case. So I would say that that issue of the out-of-service reports needs to be revisited, because it's it's an injustice to the consumers of California, especially under the circumstances which we found ourselves since December and January and the rains which caused all those outages. Again, what are the consequences of poor performance, and what is the PUC doing to improve ILEC performance and meeting those basic reporting requirements? Finally, regarding DFCA, DFCA was also has reporting requirements, and I went on it again. I went to the PUC website this morning, and I thought I'd look at the latest report. And the one I have, the report I found is dated April 2009, shows employment data for 2007 with a projection for 2008. And it further stated that new data would be submitted in 2009 to show whether projections were accurate. Subsequent reports are missing from the PUC website. And it leads me to also ask whether the franchisees are complying with the statutory reporting requirements. Are all reports, including employment reports, up to date as per statute? Why are the employment reports not submitted in a timely manner? What are the consequences for their failure to provide timely reports? And what is the methodology for verifying the accuracy of the data? Are there any consequences for inaccurate data? So regarding employment, and I would begin to question larger areas, but I think I'd like to limit my focus to employment issues regarding DFCA, because those led up to the service outages and contributed greatly to consumers being